This will be the first of two videos talking about exponential functions. First, we're going to talk about the generic exponential, and then we'll talk about the natural exponential. So these are all part of the family of functions that we need to examine next, which are both exponential and logarithmic functions. These are related because they're inverses of one another. In this chapter, we'll be dealing with the definitions of these concepts, the rules of equations involving exponentials and logarithms, and the graphs and properties of these exponential and log functions. First, let's start with the general exponential, and the definition of it is it's a function of the form a to the x, where a is greater than 0, and it's not equal to 1, because that's not very interesting. 1 to any power is just 1. And the variable, so a is a constant, and the variable is in the exponent. We can find the equation of this in general. There could also be a k out front, a constant out front, so I'll add that in there. We can find the general equation of an exponential if we have two points, and then we can use those to find both k and a. The first equation or example that we need to do is the equation of an exponential function that passes through this point. It says we want an exponential function of the form a to the x. It could also have rephrased this as saying find this format where we have the point 0, 1. That would imply that k equals 1. And so, because a to the 0 is 1, so that would imply k equals 1. So instead, they're showing you this form and giving you this point. We just plug it in. 1 over a is the output, or 1 over 8, of a cubed. So what we want to do is either take cube root or envision this as something to the third power. Well, this is 1 over 2 cubed. So this is 1 half to the third power, or 2 to the negative 1 to the third power. Or I can think of it as 1 half to the third power, whichever one you like. And then a would then be 1 half. So I have the equation 1 half to the x power. So the general graph, if we have f of x equals a to the x, looks something like this. The a is going to affect how steep this is, and it's going to go through the point 0, 1. This is all if a is greater than 1. It goes this direction. If a is less than 1, remember a has to be greater than 0, though. If a is less than 1, it models exponential growth, or decay, I mean, and it still goes through 0, 1. So this is exponential decay, and the first one was exponential growth. So this is something growing over time, and this is something decaying over time. In either case, we have a domain of all real numbers and a range from 0 to infinity, and we have a horizontal asymptote of y equals 0. Now, we can model all kinds of different functions knowing that this is the basic graph. We can transform this in ways that we've seen before and talk about what that means. So here's f of x equals negative 2 to the x. This is having a k value out front. I know a has to be greater than 0. It is here. This is negative 1 times 2 to the x. So a is 2, and it has a k value out front of negative 1. What does it mean when we put a negative out front? Well, that means we turn everything upside down over the y-axis. So it would have gone like this through the point 0, 1. So now it's going to go like this through the point 0, negative 1. So I'll connect that. This is our graph. And we just found that by looking at this as a reflection over the y-axis. So another part of equation, example 2, is g of x being 2 to the negative x. This is the same as saying 2 to the negative 1 to the x. So this is the same as 1 half to the x, our first example. It also can be viewed as taking 2 to the x and reflecting over the y-axis. So instead of going up like this, it comes down like this through the point 0, 1. So again, looking at this as either 1 half to the x or a reflection over the y-axis, we can get this general graph. And the 2, if it was 2 or 5 or 10 or whatever, it's just going to affect how steep this actually is. One application of exponential functions is that of compound interest. And this is of the form, the amount you have after time t is a factor of your principal, p, times 1 plus your rate over your number of payments. Oh, and the number of times it's compounded. And this is in, usually t is in years. And this is per year. So if I'm compounding monthly, then n is 12. And I take 12 times the number of years. If I'm compounding daily, then this is 365. And we have 365 times the number of days. Now, most of the time when we use this formula, if we want an exact answer, we're going to have to use a calculator to find it. Any simple scientific calculator will do. So you will have to do this on your homework. However, on a test, I would expect you to be able to at least set up this equation, even if you can't find the actual final answer without a calculator. All right, so here's our last example. It's a compound interest. So we have $2,500 invested at a rate of 2.5% per year, compounded monthly. Find the value after 1 year. So we want A of 1, our principal is 2,500, 1 plus your rate needs to be as a decimal, 0.025. It's compounded monthly, so this is 12, and 12 times 1. So go ahead and put that in your calculator. Remember your order of operations, that the stuff inside the parentheses goes first, and I have to divide the rate by 12, then add 1, then take it to the power 12, and then multiply by 2,500. And I get $2,563.22. Remember, a bank's not going to round up, so regardless, you should always round down on these. What if we could invest at a rate of 2% compounded daily for 1 year, which is going to give us the higher return? So we're still going to go for 1 year. Our principal's still the same, but now we're going to have a different rate, 0.02, but we're going to compound it daily. So compounding it daily means I'm adding to the interest, and the next day my interest is part of my principal. So now I'm earning interest on that too. So I'm going to expect it to give me a larger return. If it were the same exact interest rate, this would give me a larger return, compounding daily than compounding monthly. But with a lower interest rate, I got that this is equal to $25.50. Let's go ahead and find it as if it were the same interest rate so that you can see that compounding it daily does give us a slightly higher result. So go ahead and find that answer. And when I say slightly, I mean slightly, $25.63.28. So it is just a tiny bit more. Well, that's because we're only talking about a small investment. $2,500 is relatively small over a short period of time, just 1 year. So we're only gaining a little bit more, but you can imagine if this were investing in something for 40 years and investing $100,000, that difference would be a much bigger difference. So compounding monthly, that's what your normal checking or savings account will do. Compounding daily would be something special that you would get in a different kind of investment.